here. It's bringing you into the kitchen. We're having a book club tonight, so it's bringing a variety of elements of Kanata Surf Club together tonight. So people who surf, who like to read books about philosophy and science fiction and think about larger conceptual issues related to being a human being and eat really good food, really good vegan food. And so just gonna document what's going on. Might start adding more cooking wellness elements into the media program. And this is our first try. So we're gonna give it a try, see how we go. I'm gonna go through the different things that I'm making, how I'm gonna put the dinner together, sense of the timing. I don't know, so in case anybody like wants to throw a dinner, there are, let's think of the things that we have to deal with. I'm eating Khadija, Fialka, Roger, and the camera person, MG. So cooking for five, maybe make sure there's a little leftovers, maybe not. And always my philosophy is like deal with the produce that's gonna go bad first. So I've already thought about that. And try to make the meal well-rounded, have like a really nice protein, plant-based protein source, some type of carbohydrate source, want it colorful, and then, you know, green vegetables, something like that. So tonight I'm gonna make roasted spiced sweet potatoes. I'm gonna make a plant-based meatloaf kind of thing. I'm gonna make a green salad, and I'm thinking of experimenting, like my bread's not gonna be ready. I'm gonna have to make that tomorrow. So in terms of like a little bready roll thing, I'm gonna experiment with some rice and garbanzo bean dough. I have some idea for some weird fritter. We'll see if it works. All right, enough sweet potatoes. So I'm gonna add regular potatoes. Lots of vitamins. There's even protein in potatoes, if you didn't know. So get to those. Oven's at 350. And that's what it needs to be for the meatloaf, which has to cook for a long time. And I'm gonna pre-roast the potatoes just so I can warm them up later, so I don't have to do it all. Dinner's at 5:36. Okay, big baking tray. Silpat, the genius. Parchment paper is awesome, but for like oil-free or relatively low oil baking, this thing is amazing. Good question. What would a body do without organs? It wouldn't digest food.
Statistics. You could be talking about statistical models rather than
show the
content,
camera these.
I suppose. But that's how statistically set up, right? Because the implications that it draws
amazing.
In. I can't recall exactly what would it mean to...
A body without organs, I think, would be,
to be an organism. The extent which we
more
do it
collective.
Day, how necessary caution,
you know what I mean?
Because
I think they're actually tying back to Spinoza's theory.
You don't deal with sledgehammer.
Well,
you use a very fine
people
fire.
People are now calling trans-individuality.
About nothing to do with the death trap. And I wonder if... Is it, I mean,
so
this,
they're actually talking about like how
episode,
the individual integrates. That's all you need. Really?
Nose
with the silpat?
Like, well,
add the flavor on later.
But I think when I try and see it. To explore is ways in which we can experiment with ideas like not only who we are, who we should be, how we should be. And that this is always, there's no binary here, like individual collective per se. Because as they say, it's always, we're always sort of opening the body to connections to presuppose an entire assemblage. And there's always multiple assemblages, because we're always part of these different circuits and systems. And so the question is, how do we open ourselves so that we can transform it and be transformed by them? So there's this very sort of clear ethical element, I think, in this. And I kind of love it because I get my sort of... It's like an avant-garde Spinoza stuff, you know? It's great.
Amazing question that opens up something great. So I'm going to take this out of the technical realm. There's a wonderful...
Vegan meat cookbook. Miyoko Skinner. This is a super awesome book. And lots of good recipes. Lots of good high protein vegan recipes. And she uses a lot of oil, so sometimes I have her oil. Alright, taking these things out is crazy. Not made from dead animals. Totally crazy. Also not made from dead animals. And the other thing we're gonna mix a bunch of things together. Lentils, so three different protein sources. And some vegetables. Let's go. Fingers away. I'm in here anyway, so didn't have to go through all that. You don't even really have to chop. This way. The easy way. The easy way if you like doing dishes. 2 cloves of garlic, 1 half an onion.
Come on, Tate.
Got a bunch of fallen soldiers over here.
And at which point he wins, he becomes himself again. Point. The 0 point is the point of maximum potentiality and maximum risk. That is why we must take caution. There is no wisdom for handling this particular 0 point. If you go to page 160.
Little tip here, garbanzo bean juice is kind of like an egg. So it has a kind of viscosity and a binding quality. Not the same as an egg. Still a little watery. But aquafaba, it's called.
This is what I try to do with the position. If we create these bodies without working flat line, is exactly
God.
This.
You need this. Unfortunately, the topsoil is gone, so you need to take this. Don't eat animals. This is your animal replacement right here. B12 on their tongue. Get it done. I'm gonna mix all the meat mixture together. So this is like the veg part, the lentils. It was a half cup of uncooked lentils. I can give you the recipe. You can put it over the thing. All those herbs, garlic, jalapenos, all together. If you surf every day in your body that actually does have organs and you do your workouts, you can eat the fat. They're really good. No cholesterol, no clogging. So, all right, we're just gonna get gross here. Measuring actually does work, so it's not that hard to do another dish. Also, there's never enough salt. There's just never enough salt. And I do believe that if you're salting your own food at home, it's not as bad as going to restaurants. So, indulge. Garbanzo flour is just a good thickener, and it tastes really good, and it's high protein. And for you gluten-free people, it's gluten-free. And yeah, I think it'll dry it out a little bit, but I want it a little drier. It's a little moist. It's probably terrible, but it's also awesome. The Beyond Meat has plenty. The way that they make it taste so good is that they put those little fat pockets all around it, and that's what gives it that and the heme makes it seem like real meat, quote-unquote animal meat. But yeah, I definitely think people have a point to us desiring that umami and flavor. But turns out humans are so cool that we can get it without killing animals. It's totally awesome. Same feeling. It is the same feeling, swear to God. No blocked arteries. Potentially can reverse really bad autoimmune diseases. Do not see any reason to clog the arteries anymore. What are we gonna do with all those extra cows? I don't know. You know, use our imaginations. Glaze it right away. The recipe says to make a glaze. I mean, I'm trying. It's plastic. It's not even organic, but it's cheap. In it. Thank you, Bezos. Whole Foods, Amazon, ketchup, glaze. You know, compromises, people. Can't be perfect here. All right, cleanup time. Don't make fun of me, but I really want to buy this thing I saw in a commercial. I was like, what is this? And I said, Dawn Power Wash. It actually works. And then it makes your sponge cleaner. Like, your sponge is cleaner afterwards. It's a miracle of modern science, people. In that middle phase where I have nothing to do, but I could start doing another thing, which is that the vegetables are almost done, meatloaf's just chilling. Was gonna make a weird like rice pancake kind of creation thing, but now I think that's too weird and I'm just gonna go with biscuits. So I'm thinking about timing. The biscuits need a much hotter oven and they need like 12 to 14 minutes and I just have to like whip up some flour stuff. So I'm thinking about what order I want to do those things. And then I have some old vegetable broth that I cooked some seitan in. And I was thinking as I poured the vegetable broth into the pot on the stove, how when you start cooking a lot, you end up having these like random things left over that are really yummy and good that you can't necessarily tell somebody like, hey, you know, just have this awesome thick umami vegetable broth ready to go. But if you cook enough, you'll have that kind of stuff on hand. So when I cook seitan, which is another great form of vegan protein, sometimes I cook it in a broth, sometimes I steam it, but when you cook it in a broth, you want to just save the broth. So you've already made vegetable broth with your cast off vegetables. Then you cook the seitan down, add a little bit of Bragg's liquid aminos, and it becomes really rich. And I think the vital wheat gluten with a little bit of this potato flour and maybe some nutritional yeast will make it gravy-like. But we'll find out. Just kind of wing it on. I like to have a few things I just kind of wing it on. So thinking about timing, the vegetables again have to come out pretty soon. And I'm just not sure right now when to start the salad or the biscuit batter. But I think what I'll do is put out some pistachios and wipe the table down upstairs. All right. Great splurge at the grocery store for guests. I'll prep the salad, why not? You always think that like you have time to kill, but it's better to just get it all over with. Lettuce is looking good. And are these tomatoes? These things are incredible. They taste like candy. There's no rhyme or reason usually to how I chop tomatoes. So, I don't know. If somebody tells you there's a best way, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do about them and you. They taste good. Depends on how big you want the pieces. The idea, the inspiration is kind of ranch. But I don't have the exact ingredients for ranch, so I'm gonna do ranch-esque. So like a white, tangy something. Base yogurt, almond, and soy milk. 17 grams of protein, 6 grams of fat. 17 grams of protein is a lot. So it has almond milk, soy protein isolate, that's the protein, tapioca starch, and live active cultures. Pretty basic, so you know, rough. We're not exact science here. 2, 3, 4, there's 5 people, so let's say, we'll go with 5 tablespoons. This, the acid in the lemon with the dairy-like probiotic thing tends to like curdle it. That's where you get that tanginess in ranch dressing. Chopped garlic paste. And then we'll use it up on here. Yes, garlic and yogurt do go together quite well. It's done. Always black pepper. Always have Try to have a lot of spices. Onion powder. It's garlic powder. The onion powder is over here. Looks like Sophia did some kind of organization thing. A little onion powder. Spoke up the flavor a little. Oh, damn. That's really good. And add a little bit of soy milk just to make it go a little further. That's it. Ranch-ish dressing. And it doesn't have to be refrigerated because there's no animal products in it. It smells so good. Still needs to cook a little. But it is looking tasty. Just so you know, this is an important, I think, cooking lesson. Is originally I was gonna make mashed potatoes. Then I decided to make roasted potatoes. Now I'm looking at these roasted potatoes. They're a little dry. And now I'm looking at more like a salad. Like, what more can I put with them? And I'm just thinking like olives and parsley would be really nice. So I'm gonna do that. Not very meticulous with my herb leaf foraging. Always kind of go a little rogue and choppy here. Looks pretty good. It's really not a big deal to measure. Just get into it. Pretty good. Same principle as in regular buttermilk biscuits. You just curdle the milk. That's what makes it buttermilk. The milk gets curdled. There's an acid component with the creamy, milky component. Kind of like when coffee is too acidic and you pour in a nut milk or a soy milk and it turns into one of those brains and it's disgusting. About a tablespoon, and you can just see it curdling. If you want to see, you can see it curdling immediately. One. We use King Arthur. That's our favorite flour. They have cool recipes too. Two. Okay, done with the flour. Rising agent. 2 teaspoons baking powder. One. Okay, that's done. My bread is not going to be done, so we're doing biscuits.
Oh, well, biscuits sounds good.
So, that's what's going on. Do you have anything? And T-Rock is looking for food on the floor. That's what's going on right now. But that looks pretty good, right? That came out looking pretty good. Oven preheated to 475 for the biscuits. The flour mixture is here. We have the curdled soy milk, and for whatever reason, I'm deciding to put the melted earth balance. I don't know if you caught that. It's the vegan margarine. Not healthy. Going a little higher calorie on this meal, but, you know, Saturday night, getting crazy. Didn't waste any. Just get all the butter all in there. That's what's going to make them flaky. Milk. Clumpy. I hope you like it. All right, T-Rock. That drop. Okay.
thank you.
But it is interesting now that I'm way further along and you can see more what Lynch was doing in the Lynch movie. I don't know if you guys have seen that one, but
yeah.
If you're a person that's only read the first, even honestly, I feel like as the novels go through, you know more about each kind of person from each kind of thing. A little bit more, because the history grows and he's like building this mythology, so,
yeah.
There's always a question of like what is the history of the Bene Gesserits, and like we've talked a lot about the way that they wield power in the structure of the novel, and actually their power becomes, I would say, like less behind the curtains and more explicit as the novels move forward.
Yeah, because they step out on center stage.
Right. Well, because the arc of his novels is towards an ever increasing evolutionary force towards a kind of feminism.
Yeah.
Of women and power. Women always have power in every novel, but the way that they hold power and the structures of their power change from novel to novel, i.e. get stronger.
Like more direct, you mean?
More direct. But I would say, like, more direct, but more public.
Yeah. More explicit. Right?
More public, yeah. Not just from behind the scenes of the male ruler.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. T-Rock, you want trazodone?
Yes, please, I love trazodone.
You want trazodone?
I think so.
Yeah? Time for a traz? He's asking for it. He's like, well, it comes with peanut butter, so.
Well, what's interesting about
the Bene Gesserit, the breathing lines.
Yeah, is that... At first, you kind of think of it, in book one, you think of the Bene Gesserit as like an adversary of the central characters. And after a while, they are the central character.
Uh-huh. Not an adversary.
Because you have the Mother Superior in book one who is doing everything she can to...
They have adversaries. And they have, they're a power structure, so they ally themselves with certain characters,
mm-hmm.
and are at odds with other characters or institutional structures.
Mm-hmm.
And then they break off for certain reasons. You know, Jessica's like always this problem, and there's a problem with love.
Yeah.
Right? They're in their training. They're there. And those problems within the Bene Gesserit order, there are similar problems in each organized power structure in the novel.
Well, that's what's kind of fun about it, is that he's just doing this, like, very clear thing. It's not that, like, you know, it's like, it doesn't really matter whether you're a man or a woman at the end of the day. Once you, like, have, like, you're stepping in, you're being powerful, they like, start to, like, get greedy. Would they reproduce them? I can't remember.
We would have to, like, really get into that part in the fifth book where it talks about that. Because the fifth book starts to really focus on the Tleilaxu.
Yeah.
They take them out of the planet for sure. I just can't remember if they...
Yeah, because the
happens.
I think the Bene Gesserit are the only ones who have a worm at this point. And
well, there are worms again on Rakkus because of the division...
But they destroyed Rakkus.
Eventually. But they came back when they renamed the planet after like.
But then they the honored Matres completely destroyed Dune, and it's just like it's just melting.
I think that's in in Heretics or in Chapters.
It's either in the beginning. I think it's at the end of Heretics, and it gets explained in Chapter House that they provoked the honored Matres into destroying Dune. So now the only worm is on Chapter House. Was taken to Chapter House and they seeded Chapter House, which is now turning into Dune.
Interesting.
And the honored mantra is also destroy the
Tlaylaxu,
who were producing spice in their tanks.
In their tanks, yeah.
Their tanks, which are humans.
Yeah, it's so crazy. I don't understand the tanks thing. To me, it's like this thing that just creates. It's like a box that just creates everything.
Yeah, the tank turns out.
Nobody understands what the
tanks turn out to be women.
Mm. Oh, because they never know where the Tlaylaxu women are.
Right. Yeah. They're tanks.
So
they're
what the
using
fuck does
them.
That mean?
They're using,
well, they're
the,
using
women
the women as
to produce all of their genetic stuff.
They're like 3D printer women.
Yeah,
so and that's interesting too. With
and
the
when the honored
mantras
figure
printing.
That out, when they
yeah.
figure that, I mean, not when the Bene Gesserit figure that out, it's just like, oh my god.
T-Rock's fine, by
the way. Yeah, and the honored mantras destroy the Tlaylaxu, so there's no spice. There's no more spice being produced anywhere. In the last book.
I'm not there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The
yeah, exactly.
But then finally the plot starts kicking
in here.
The gear.
Okay,
in the second
some
half.
Red peppers.
Or about like 30%.
So
I
nice.
Read on
and roasted sweet potatoes and regular potatoes with olives and parsley. And so, yeah.
Did you learn to cook some of this stuff the first time you were vegan, or is it going to completely new?
I just cook a lot in general. So,
cheers.
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 Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Guys, cheers to you, MG.
Cheers.
Cheers. I, his Satan is so good. I've been telling people that I'm Satan curious.
Well,
because,
no,
because it, I was like, okay, I gotta learn how to make this.
It's really easy. Trying to make my vegan argument through cooking.
Seems really complicated.
Yeah, same. I was like, oh, that's just around the problem.
It's not any more complicated than to cook a meatloaf for me.
Huh.
So, that's a complicated dish if it needs, like, we have to cook something.
How do you make a seitan?
We just buy it all equally.
Yeah.
You just make
it
well.
Boil or something, right?
No, you just boil it now.
It's like bagels.
Here's foil now. It's pretty basic. Mm-hmm. So, in the future, there's like a planetary cl- like, there's actually, this is a thing that just we imagine a lot, but we've never had, which is, like, galaxy, but there are lots of inhabitable planets.
Yeah.
Even if some are, like, harder to inhabit, like, instead we have planets on one planet that are really radically different. And I think a lot of time in like science fiction imagination, or in our imagination, like, we imagine all those different microclimates we have on Earth like as their own kind of planet.
Yeah.
So like in the science fiction imagination, there's like one planet that's all sand dunes.
Yeah.
One planet that's all like one kind of climate that we have on Earth.
Does it play out the same way in Dune?
Mm-hmm. So, but... changes, I guess. More of the planets are like Earth. It seems they have water and trees.
I feel like animals from Earth too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are dogs that get turned into tigers.
And tigers, like I guess cyber tigers.
Mm-hmm.
There's a cross between
cats
and people that show up.
Oh, really?
Futars.
I didn't
see that. Never seen it.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Alright, now I'm very excited.
It's good.
You gave Dune such a ringing endorsement.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's amazing, guys.
I mean, I want to find, like, there's these philosophy bits that are just insanely good. Okay. This is just on prop. So, like, he has these epigrams that are, like, they're just, like, a philosophy text. But they hold a place within the context
the
of the overall
yeah.
mythology of this future civilization. So this one is about prophets. The prophet is not diverted by illusions of past, present, and future. The fixity of language determines such linear distinctions. Prophets hold a key to the lock in a language. Actually, that just now reminds me of later on when they talk about the key log in this one, Heretics of Dune. The mechanical image remains only an image to them. This is not a mechanical universe. The linear progression of events is imposed by the observer. Cause and effect? That's not it at all. The prophet utters fateful words. You glimpse a thing destined to occur. But the prophetic instant releases something of an infinite portent and power. The universe undergoes a ghostly shift. Thus, the wise prophet conceals actuality behind shimmering labels. The uninitiated then believe the prophetic language is ambiguous. The listener distrusts the prophetic messenger. Instinct tells you how the utterance blunts the power of such words. The best prophets lead you up to the curtain and let you peer through for yourself.
That's good. Yeah. Can I take a look at
one? Yeah. That's my favorite one so far, is the...